Matthew chapter number 2. Matthew chapter number 2. Now, hopefully by now, we're almost into March. You've kind of got over the Christmas, feel. Now, I'm a Christmas person, so, I'll give it a couple months, and then I might start listening to Christmas music again, all right? That's my prerogative. But I just enjoy Christmas and all that goes into that. So I say all that because it seems weird that we're talking about kind of the Christmas story in Matthew chapter number 2. And we've started this series really just a few weeks ago. We began in Matthew chapter number 1 and worked our way through that and now into Matthew chapter number 2. And we're going to be looking at verse number 13 specifically today and on through verse number 23, the rest of Matthew chapter number 2. But as we think about this, I mean, we understand, we know the story of Mary and Joseph, and we see them in the manger, and we've heard all of those things a multitude of times, and we might even have that little, kind of a set or a decoration in our house during Christmas time, and we've heard about the wise men, and we've heard about all of these things that take place. But the story doesn't end there. It continues on, and that's what we're going to read about today in Matthew chapter number 2. So if you find verse number 13, if you'll stand with me, and we'll just read a few verses here if you're physically able. Matthew chapter number 2, verse number 13, just a few verses here, and we'll get into the message this morning. Bible says, and when they were departed, behold, that they is the wise men. You remember, they heard from the Lord, they went another way, didn't go back to Herod. When they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeareth to Joseph in a dream, saying, Arise, and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Out of Egypt have I called my son. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coast thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, saying, In Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and would not be comforted because they are not. Let's pray. Lord, again, we've prayed several times this morning. Lord, we don't want to make it a trite thing or just something that we do because it's a place to fit into the service. We desperately need to hear from you. We need your help. And so we're asking, Lord, for you today to enlighten the Scripture. Help us to understand what is being said here. And then, Lord, help us not to just understand it, but please help us to apply it to our lives. Help us to live out the truth of what's being said here. Thank you very much for your protection, for your provision. And we ask your help in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. So we've been left in the dark about most of Jesus' early life, so to speak. We know the passage where his parents take him to Jerusalem, and about the age of 12, he's left back behind, and they thought, like most parents, I'm sure he's somewhere. I'm sure he's with some other family, or he's playing somewhere. And so they get down the road, and they're like, we haven't seen our son. And so they go back to Jerusalem and they go back to the temple and they're amazed to find him in the temple. And we've known that story, and that's really kind of the only glimpse, if you will, that we get to see inside of his young life outside of this story here in Matthew chapter number 2. If you'll remember, we looked at the wise men and how they had gone. And in verse number 2 of chapter number 2, they had been looking for this child, this baby who had been, and the phrase that the Bible uses, such a great term, born king of the Jews. And we made statement that no one is born a king. That just doesn't happen. Now, you might be born a prince or in the royal line, but this child was different. He was born king of the Jews. And it's such a tremendous statement, but at the same time, Matthew records for us that there wasn't just one who was considered king of the Jews. There was another man named Herod who had been put and placed as king of the Jewish people at that time by Caesar Augustus, the same Caesar who had ordered the census that we read about in Luke chapter number 2. So if you go back in your Bible and just read a couple of verses here, or you can kind of review with me, chapter 2, verse number 7, then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star, that is the star they had been following, appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem. Now why Bethlehem? Well, because if you remember, the Jewish leaders knew where Jesus was going to be born, but they weren't watching for his birth. They knew the place and they knew the time, but they weren't watching because they had replaced Jesus with their own way of doing things, with their own style, their own doctrine, so to speak, and they had really misplaced Christ. But they knew the place, and so Herod, verse 8, sends the wise men to Bethlehem and said, now listen, go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again, now listen, that I may come and worship him also. Right. Now that's not Herod's motive. And we're going to see that here later on in the chapter. In fact, we read some of those verses, that Herod's motive is not to worship this newborn king. Herod's motive is to eliminate any rival, anybody that would come and have some kind of claim on the throne that he already possesses. He's trying to eliminate them from the face of the earth. And so, when the wise men finished their worship, the Bible says in verse number 12 of Matthew 2, that as God had directed them, as God had warned them, they return a different way, and they don't bring Herod word again. And we again made the observation that they act in a same manner or a similar manner that their name is. They act as wise men. And let's always be reminded that the Bible says that the fool has said in his heart there is no God. If I want to act foolish, then I will act. I will live my life in such a way that there is no God. I will do things, engage in activities. I will say things with my mouth. I will even think things. My motives will be wrong because I'm a fool. I act like there is no God. If I want to be wise, however, the flip side of that is I will act like there is a God if I want to be a wise man, a wise woman. And that's what these wise men did. They listened to God's direction and they obeyed God's call, His plan for their life, if you will. They simply, we sing the song, they trusted and obeyed. I can't get over the fact that this passage is so simple in its application. It's almost embarrassing just to simply trust and obey. But you know what you and I have the most difficulty with? Trusting and obeying. Because I don't always see what's beyond. I don't always see what God has planned. I can't see 5 minutes down the road. There's no way that I can predict the future. No matter what the palm reader or the tarot card reader wants to try to sell to me, they can't know the future. Neither can I. There's only one person that can tell my future, and that's Almighty God. And by the way, much of my future has already been told to me. It's now my responsibility to trust what God has said and then to obey what God is giving, His direction in my life. And here's where we are in our passage this morning. God's brought our attention from chapter 1, the genealogy of Jesus, to the obedience then, the end part of chapter number 1, of Joseph and Mary, to now the story of these wise men and what Herod's reaction is when he learns of this other king that has come. And what Matthew is going to do in this passage of Scripture in Matthew 2 is going to set the stage for the rest of what the book of Matthew is. It's this grand battle of light versus darkness, of good versus evil. And no matter what people try to say today, there is a battle between good and evil. There are people that want to side with good, with what God has said, with God's truth on the matter of social issues or whatever the case may be. That the issue of salvation, the issue of all truth comes from God. All truth is God's truth. I cannot say, well, that's true for you, it's not true for me. What's true in the Bible is true for everybody. So there's this matter of good, God is good, do I side with God? Or there's the other side of evil. Evil is the enemy of good. And Satan's goal from Genesis chapter number 3, from really the foundation of the world, has been to destroy God's plan for bringing salvation to you and to me. If he can eliminate God's Son, who is going to provide salvation, then he can eliminate the opportunity for you and I to have forgiveness of sins. He can eliminate the opportunity for you and I to have a hope of heaven. And so his goal is to destroy Jesus Christ, to destroy his testimony. And in Matthew 2, Satan is going to try to use Herod, this king, to accomplish that task. But as we read through it, and as we get to the end of Matthew chapter number 2, we're going to see at the end of the message that you and I can rejoice in God's protective hand on our life. We can rejoice in God's hand, his protection, his provision for every aspect of my life. And I can rest in the fact that God knows every detail of my life. Even the things that I do not know, God knows. Even the things that I don't know are coming down the road, God already does. And by the way, if I'm God's child, he is providing the way for me. He is protecting. He is making things happen even now that I do not know of, that will meet my every need, that will protect me in times of danger. He's already working on my behalf. I can rest in those things. Even when every bit of my flesh doesn't want to rest, it wants to worry. I've met a lot of good worriers, because I know a lot of humans. We're great at worrying. In fact, we're probably professionals at it. We stress and just worry. We lose sleep over things because we somehow, for some reason, think that our worry is going to fix our problems. And I'm going to tell you, friend, it can never fix your problems. You might stay up at night and you might deliberate over things, but it's never going to fix your problems. So, a couple of thoughts here and we'll move our way through the passage. Thought number one, you and I can rest when we simply obey God's direction. I can rest in the truth of God when I follow His direction. So once the wise men leave here, in verse number 13, we're told of this angel that appears to Joseph by a dream, warning him of the danger that is coming, and instructing Joseph to take his wife and to take their young child now to Egypt, south to Egypt, and to stay there until God gives further direction. Now, Egypt at this time was a Roman province. In fact, according to a Jewish philosopher named Philo, there was about 1 million Jews living in Egypt at this time. So it wasn't like he's telling them to go where they won't know anybody, where they won't be able to be acclimated. No, there's already maybe 1 million Jews living in Egypt. By the way, do you remember what the wise men gave when they came to worship Jesus? You remember that? We talked about that last week. Gold and frankincense and myrrh. Now those gifts, and we mentioned it, are symbolic gifts, but also I believe God fully knew what he was doing and allowed those wise men to bring those gifts, because that's going to provide for Joseph and Mary and Jesus to travel to Egypt, to find a place to live, to get settled in. And all of those things, God is just working behind the scenes to bring all of this together to provide for his son. And so in verse number 14, it's so simple. Joseph doesn't fight. Joseph just simply obeys God's orders. Look again at verse number 14. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt. Boy, there's such simplicity in following God's orders. If God says to do this, to stand here, to make my choice and then to obey, then isn't it simple for me to obey? I've mentioned a few times my dad was a drill sergeant. I learned what the word obey means very soon, very quickly. And I learned the consequences of disobedience. And it was much simpler when I would just do what my dad told me to do. For example, young people, forgive me. I'm going to say some very bad words here, okay? Son, take out the garbage. I don't want to take out the garbage. No, I want to keep doing what I'm doing. If I don't take out the garbage, there's consequences for not taking out the garbage. It's simpler for me to just obey orders. And so what Joseph is doing in Matthew chapter number 2 is simply what you and I are supposed to do. If God gives me orders, it's much more simple for me to simply do what it is He told me to do rather than trying to come up with excuses or lie and say why I shouldn't do what God's telling me to do, because then I got to remember the lie and I'm already complicating the issue. If God is directing me, it's just easier for me to do it rather than to come up with an excuse or reason or simply not do it. Now, I'm not saying I nor always or even very often understand why God gives some of His directions, but remember, I don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. I don't have to understand why my dad tells me to do something fully to obey right away. I don't have to understand all that what God is instructing me to do, the reasons why He's telling me to do that, to simply obey. In fact, He, for very good reasons, tells me, son, all I'm telling you right now is to do this. You might see later why I told you to do this, but right now, all I'm telling you is to obey. Just listen. Just be obedient. Just humble yourself and follow me. I don't. You don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. And it's so clear to see as you read Matthew 2 that God is in complete control of this situation. There's not a circumstance. There's not a little nuance. There's not anything that comes up that God says, whoops, I missed that one. All of these things are under God's control. He knows everything that is happening here, and nothing goes unnoticed by Him. He's provided the way for Joseph and Mary and Jesus to travel away from danger, and when the time is perfect, He gets His message to His willing servant. And sadly, that's where it oftentimes breaks down, is you and I aren't always the willing servants. See, God will get His message to us, but the issue is I'm not always the willing servant. I listen to what God says, and I read God's Word, and I try to get truth from it, but then when He tells me to do something, or He burdens my heart about something, or He says, son, this is what you need to do. You need to go to speak to that person, give them a word of encouragement. You need to witness to that person, or hand them an invitation to church, or whatever the case may be. I hear it, but I don't always do it. And I'm a disobedient son. And God's not the reason why communication breaks down. The reason communication breaks down is because me. I don't listen. I don't obey. I'm not willing to serve the Lord. I'm much more willing to oftentimes serve self. But Joseph, in our passage, was a willing servant. Don't you think that Joseph had learned that God could and would protect his child? I think he very well did. Look again at Matthew chapter number 1. I just want to remind you what has happened in Joseph's life. Look on verse number 20. You remember he finds out that his wife, who is a virgin, is now with child. And it's a problem for him. So verse 20 of chapter number 1. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife. For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And notice verse 21. She shall bring forth a son. Thou shalt call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. In other words, hey, Joseph, I have a plan for this child that I'm giving to Mary. Don't think for one minute that I'm going to let anything happen to him until my will for his life is accomplished. He is to be called Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. So if I'm Joseph, if I hear of this threat of a king that's trying to kill me and my family, or at least trying to kill my son, don't you think that I ought to believe that what God said is true? And I can believe that if he has a purpose for his life, he's going to spare him. He's going to protect him. He's going to watch over him. Well, if he does that for Jesus, doesn't God have promises for your life also? He said very clearly, son, daughter, I'll never leave you or forsake you. I will take care of every need that you have. Don't worry about those things. I'm God. I know you have need of them before you do. I'll take care of you. It's your duty, your responsibility, just to follow. Trust in God's protective hand for your life. And so Joseph learned the lesson. We can rest when we obey God's direction. Number two, we can rest, according to Matthew 2, when we trust God's promises. Notice with me verse number 15 of Matthew chapter number 2. We can rest when we trust God's promises. And was there, that is Joseph and Mary and Jesus, was there in Egypt until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. Now, if you have cross references in your Bible, there's probably a little note that points you back to Hosea chapter number 11 and verse number 1. And if you were to go back, and we won't do that for sake of time this morning, but the immediate context of Hosea 11:1 is the nation of Israel and God bringing Israel out of Egypt. If you remember that story, Moses using Moses to deliver the nation of Egypt from bondage. But what Matthew is doing in Matthew chapter number 2 is he's illustrating for us that the New Testament is in the Old Testament concealed, but the old in the new is revealed. So what Matthew does is, again, from a Jewish mind, writing to Jewish readers, really for the most part, he's giving the understanding that Jesus is the ultimate embodiment of the nation of Israel. Right? Just as I took care of my people and brought them out of Egypt, Hosea 11:1, in the same manner, Matthew 2, verse number 15, my son, I'm showing you, he's the ultimate embodiment of my love, my care, my protection, my deliverance for the world is found in my son. And yes, he may be going into Egypt for a time, but I'm bringing him out of Egypt. And again, remember, Matthew is trying to tie together Old Testament truth with New Testament reality. Right? So in the Old Testament, we have Israel being taken out of Egypt. In the New Testament, we have Jesus going into Egypt, one day to be taken out. It's a display of how Christ was so tied in with the Jewish people. He came for them. He's brought to them, presented to them, and yet they rejected. Now, questions. Did God promise to deliver and take care of the nation of Israel? Yes. Yes. You remember he told Abraham, I'm going to make you the father of many nations, and those that bless you, I will bless. Those that curse you, I will curse. Could Joseph then rest in the promise of God to deliver and care for him and his new family, which included the Savior of all mankind? Could Joseph rest in that promise? Yes. Yes, no question about it. So again, can I rest in God's promises for me and for my life? Yes. Yes, I can rest in the things that God has given to me. So now those two themes are found in the rest of the chapter, beginning in verse number 16. Notice how the story continues. Then Herod, verse 16, Matthew 2, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. So a period of time passes, and Herod begins to realize, hey, those wise men aren't coming back here. They're not telling me exactly the location and the place and the time of Jesus being there or this king of the Jews. They're mocking me, and that's the word that the Bible uses. And the word literally means to play with or to deceive. Now, that's not what the wise men did. That's Herod's perception of what they did. And as I'm studying for this and reading through various commentators, one of the greatest preachers of all time, Charles Spurgeon, here's what he said about this passage of Scripture. I thought it was a great quote. Proud men are quick to imagine insults. Proud men are quick to imagine insults. They think everything is about them, and every comment, every statement is about them, and they make it a personal issue. And so in verse number 16, Herod is furious because he doesn't want to go and worship Jesus. He's not mad because they didn't tell him where to go to worship. He's mad because his motive was something vastly different. And what can only appear to be motivated by Satan himself, he begins to take the lives of the children that were in Bethlehem from 2 years old and younger. He asks the wise men what time the star appeared in verses 7 and 8, and he gets the time frame, and instead of going out and searching for the child himself, the Bible says very clearly that he's blinded by rage, blinded by jealousy, and he has all of the children killed. He's doing everything he can to get rid of Jesus. The Bible says in John 8:44 that Satan is a liar and a murderer. That's exactly what Herod is here. He lies to the wise men and he murders young children. His motive wasn't ever to worship Christ. His motive never was to humble himself and bow a knee. All along, his desire was to eliminate every rival he saw to his throne. And so, we read in verses 17 and 18 that even this act was a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. Then was fulfilled, verse 17, that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, or Jeremiah, saying, "In Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation, weeping, great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not." You know, the first mention of Bethlehem in the scripture is Jacob. In Genesis 35, Jacob has a wife. Her name is Rachel. He loves Rachel. In fact, the Bible says that he worked years to gain Rachel's hand in marriage. Rachel passes off the scene, and in Genesis 35, Bethlehem is mentioned. And if you remember, she gives birth to these sons, and the son is named Benoni, son of my sorrow. She dies in childbirth to this son. Jacob then changes the child's name to Benjamin, in other words, son of my right hand. And it's just amazing, once again, how the scripture all ties together. Those names both relate to Jesus Christ. Jesus was, according to Isaiah 53, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But the Bible also says in the book of Acts chapter 5, Hebrews chapter 1, that he is the son of God's right hand. Jacob puts up a pillar to memorialize his wife's death, and it's near Bethlehem. Jeremiah's prophecy that is quoted here in in Matthew 2, verses 17 and 18, this was given 600 years before Jesus is even born. It came about the time during the Babylonian captivity. And what Jeremiah the prophet does is not give Jacob the weeping. He's referencing the wife, Rachel, doing the weeping. In other words, Jeremiah is referencing these children who are being taken away out of their land into captivity into Babylon. What Matthew does again, tying Old Testament scripture with New Testament reality, he is applying this to the killing of these young people in Bethlehem because of rage, anger, jealousy, pride, all of those things. And it's amazing how God has prophesied all of this to take place. Now, I want to be very clear. That is not to say that God ordained the killing of these young people. It's simply a prophecy that God knew would take place. And he's again, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit in Matthew 2, tying those events together. Okay, all that being said, what does that mean? We can trust God's word to come to pass. What God said is true, and I can trust that what he has said will come to pass. That ought to be a comforting truth. Because if you've read what some people might do in their English literature class, read the end of the story before they read the middle, and find out the end. You ever pick up a novel and read the back of the book? I'm like, I read that book. I know what happens. No, I've read the end of the Bible. Guess what? Jesus wins. You're a child of the King. You enjoy victory with Him. Again, though you might not understand all that you and I might go through right now, I don't understand why things happen in the world that they do. I don't understand why things happen even in our city like they do. But I can tell you this, God knows. God sees. I can trust that what God said to happen will take place. And so the passage then takes a turn in verse number 19. It seems like there's nothing but trouble and trial and struggle and it's a dark time. But notice verse number 19, the first few words. But when Herod was what? Dead. The man who was so quick to kill anybody. You remember, he kills his own family because he's jealous that they might try to take his throne. He takes the lives of many young people in the city of Jerusalem because he's just jealous that somebody might take his spot. They might take his title. But the same fate is true of Herod that is true of every person that walks the face of the earth. But when Herod was dead, at one point in life, you and I are going to breathe our last breath. Is appointed unto men once to die. After this, the judgment. And so no matter what we try to make work, no matter the position we try to gain for ourselves, no matter how we might try to manipulate things in our life, understand, you and I are facing death every moment of every day. And God says, I know that you're facing death. It's a penalty for sin. This flesh will die, but God's made you in His own image. In other words, there's a soul and a spirit that's inside of you. And you will spend eternity somewhere forever. But when Herod was dead, behold, verse number 19, an angel of the Lord appeareth in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, Arise, and take the young child and his mother, and go into the land of Israel, for they are dead, which sought the young child's life. The way it's presented is such a harsh reality. In fact, in verse number 20, the angel that speaks to Joseph doesn't even mention Herod's name. They are dead which sought the young child's life. It's just such a harsh contrast. See, Herod thought he had everything planned out. Man, I can take care of things. I'm the boss. I'm in leadership. Everything I can do, the people, I can get people to do whatever it is I tell them to do. I'm in control of my life. And God says, no, you're not. No, you're not. No, I'm in control of your life, Herod. Son, I'm in control of your life. Daughter, I'm in control of your life. It's not your job to try to find a way to make ends meet or to make things work out. That's my responsibility, is what our Heavenly Father says. It's my job as child, as created being, to get in line and follow. And so once again, we read that Joseph rested enough in God's direction to trust the message of God, and he brings his family then back to Israel. Verse number 21, he arose, took the young child and his mother, and came to the land of Israel. Now, along with the news of Herod's death, the angel gives Joseph additional instructions to return to Israel. Once again, Joseph trusts, but in verse number 22, we learn that Herod's son has now taken the throne. He's also unsympathetic to the Jews, and Joseph knows this, and so he has a bit of fear or of doubt, or should I really be doing this? And once again, we witness God giving direction to his humble servant. Verse number 23, he came, dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. Again, it's just prophecy after prophecy after prophecy after prophecy that's taking place here in Matthew chapter number 2, and Joseph has to learn the lesson. I can rest in God's promises. What God said will happen will come to pass. Okay, that all sounds fine. But what about in my life? What does that mean for me today? Thank you for asking. Take your Bible, if you would, and we're almost done, to Psalm chapter number 2. Psalm 2, and we'll finish off. Psalm 2 is a tremendous passage of Scripture. And I want to read you and just make some application and we're done. Now remember, the sovereignty of God in the affairs of men. God brings about the birth and the life of the Messiah, His Son on the earth. Second, we see the need to confess and trust Christ as personal Savior rather than oppose Him as Herod had done. So, a couple questions here. Do you believe that God has a plan and a purpose for your life? You should. Romans chapter number 12, verses 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable, here it is, will of God. God has a perfect plan and purpose for your life. Don't ever doubt that. Right? Well, I'm not a preacher. I don't, you know, sing in the choir. I don't serve in church somewhere. You know, I'm just kind of living. Guess what? God directs and guides, and we need all kinds of good Christian people in all kinds of business affairs. Now, get this. I don't want to make everybody go crazy. We need good Christian lawyers. Yeah, we do. Yeah. Yeah. We need good Christian doctors. Yeah. We need good Christian businessmen. We need good Christian politicians. We need good Christian garbage men. You understand, we need good Christian people in this society that we live in today. You and I are supposed to be salt and light. I have a duty and a will and a purpose that God has given for my life. I need to trust that and then get in line with what God's will is for my life. Question two, do you believe God knows and understands every detail of your life and can give you protective care every moment? Do you believe that? You should. Let me read you Matthew 10. Again, don't turn there. I'll just read it to you. Matthew 10, verse number 28. Fear not them which kill the body, but are able not to kill the soul. Rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing, and one of them shall not fall to the ground without your Father? But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. I'm trying to help the Lord out with that one. Fear ye not, therefore, you right now, you sitting in that pew, ye are of more value than many sparrows. Church, can I just encourage you? Boy, we live in a society today that wants to save every animal and wants to kill young children. Understand, the Bible says, you and I, every person that breathes air that God has created, is much more valuable than any bird that flies, any creature that crawls on the face of the earth. You're much more valuable than them. We would believe in the sanctity of life. We ought to simply obey, trust God in those things. I understand. God knows every detail of my life. I can trust Him. Question number three. Do you believe that God knows exactly who your enemy is and that He is well able to handle anything your enemy tries to harm you with? You should. Look at Psalm 2. Psalm 2 is a prophetic psalm, and the nature of the prophecy is of this coming Messiah. And it describes the vanity of the nations of the world who conspired together, the kings of the earth who try to take their stand, that's verses 2 and 3, against the Lord and against His anointed one. Look at Psalm 2, verse 1. Why do the heathen rage? And the people imagine a vain thing. The kings of the earth, the rulers, the leaders, set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. In other words, they're saying, if we do what God is telling us to do, all that's going to be is bondage. We're just going to live in bondage, and He's going to tell us what to do, and we're going to have to obey, and if He doesn't, then He's going to strike us dead. Let's break those bands asunder. Let's go our own way and try to find our own path. Sounds a lot like Herod in Matthew chapter number 2. Trying to strike out on his own, go out his own way, trying to go against God's anointed. Because men do not want God's Messiah to reign over them. Men want to rule themselves. It's just called this flesh that we live in. You can't tell me what to do. I want things my way. Burger King, remember those commercials? You can have it your way. Because it just feeds what... Don't tell me what to do. Don't tell me I need to have lettuce on my hamburger if I don't want lettuce on my hamburger. I mean, we reduce it to such silly terms, but that's how we live our life. But God isn't troubled by the rebellion in Psalm chapter number 2. In fact, verse 4, the Bible describes the only time that God laughs. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Notice verse 6. God has set up His king in Zion. Notice verse 7. He will protect and provide for His son. God will give to His son the nations for His inheritance. Verse number 8. All the ends of the earth will be His possession. Jesus Christ, the Bible says, will rule and reign with an iron scepter. That's verse number 9. He will break them in pieces like pottery. God's enemies are nothing to Him. So, okay, that's God, but now what are we supposed to do? Again, glad you asked. Turn your attention to verse number 10. With all of that truth, here's what you and I are supposed to do. What are the first two words? Be wise. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Notice, it goes on. Be instructed, ye judges of the earth. Look at verse 11. Serve the Lord with fear. Rejoice with trembling. Overall, verse 12. Kiss the Son in grateful, loving submission. And then look at how verse 12 ends. Blessed are all they that put their what? Trust in who? In Him. Not in yourself, not in your way, not in doing your own thing. Blessed are all they that put their trust in Him. Now, that's not what God's enemies do. And it's why all of those who decide to trust in God are not in danger of a fierce and a final destruction. My warning, the Bible says in verse 10, verse 11, my warning is not to be among the ungodly. Not to be among those who are the enemies of Almighty God. Psalm 2, the enemies of Christ rage against Him. But why should you? You understand this morning Jesus Christ holds out His loving arms of grace and mercy and says, anyone who wants to come can come. You don't have to try to work to earn God's love or God's mercy or God's grace. Our verse of the month, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, how's that? By faith. So walk ye in Him by faith. I'm not earning God's grace. I'm not earning God's love. He gives it freely to me. My only responsibility is to follow, obey, to trust. Have you put your trust in Jesus Christ and Him alone for salvation? Period. Not Jesus plus baptism. Not Jesus plus giving in the offering. Not Jesus plus being in attendance at church on Sunday morning. Not Jesus plus reading my Bible. All of those things are good and right to do. But what God says is, do you trust in my Son? His name is Jesus. He shall save His people from their sin. Because it's His gift. Because that's His desire, is to do that. God doesn't desire for any to perish and to spend eternity in a flaming hell. He doesn't want that. He's not slack concerning His promises. Some men count slackness, but His long-suffering to us, we're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And I believe that the best thing for every person here to do today, the best thing for every person here to do tomorrow, the best thing for every person to do every day is just find God's direction and follow it. Just follow it. And I've found in my own life, when I'm in line and following Jesus, I don't get out of line. It's a lot harder for me to disobey when I'm just following. You understand, when I follow, I'm not being disobedient. I mean, it's so simple, but yet we get it messed up all the time. Because we get distracted and we go our own way and we're not any longer following the Savior. Follow, follow, follow. But I like to be the boss. Well, that's going to end someday because every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. By the way, He's not some boss to keep you under His thumb. He's a loving Heavenly Father who knows how to give the best gifts to you if you will follow. Boy, that sounds like the best plan for my life. If I'll follow, He will bless and help. Oh, so it will all be easy. I wish, but no. It won't be easy. Sometimes it's going to be very hard. Sometimes trial might come as a result of you following. But understand this, you don't go alone. Your Father's with you every step of the way. It's your responsibility, it's my responsibility to trust and to obey. Don't just sing it, do it. Let's pray. Lord, thank You very much again for the day. Thank You very much for the truth of the Bible. Lord, we're grateful for what You've said. And really, in Matthew chapter number 2, it's a simple story. You give direction, and then your servant simply obeys. Because, Lord, You're giving protection. You're watching out for him, for his family. If You watched out for Joseph and Mary and the Lord Jesus, the Bible says very clearly, Lord, that You'll watch out for me and my family, for these people and their family, if we will obey. So please help us to be humble servants. Not trying to forge our own way or do our own thing. Not trying to correct Scripture or go against what You've said. Not saying, well, this is 2017 and the Bible's not relevant anymore. No, it's very relevant. It's very needy for us. Please help us to be obedient to it. And Lord, if there's someone here today that doesn't know Jesus as their personal Savior, would You please help them to understand, number one, just like every other person, they're a sinner. And Lord, You love them enough that You sent Your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for their sin. And that if they'll put their trust in Jesus alone for salvation, the Bible says their sins are forgiven and you will give them eternity, an eternal home in heaven. Lord, if there's someone here today that hasn't done that, help today to be the day. Well, thank you for it. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I don't want to embarrass you. I'm not going to have you make a speech. I want to pray for you. My prayer won't save you. That's what God does. You have to trust Him. But in the quietness of the moment, you lift your hand long enough for me to see it. Preacher, would you pray? I'm not certain that I'm saved. I don't remember a time when I've understood my sin, understood there's a Savior, and if I'll confess my sin and trust Him, He'll save me. I don't remember ever doing that. Would you pray for me? Anyone at all? You just lift your hand long enough for me to see it. Put it right back down. Preacher, would you pray? I'm not certain I've ever done that. Anyone at all? Preacher, would you pray? I don't remember a time I've done that, or I'm uncertain about that. Anyone at all? Preacher, pray. I don't know for sure I'm saved. All right? Then many of you didn't raise your hand. I would expect that means I understand you're saved. You've trusted Christ as your personal Savior and you know that. That's the best decision you'll ever make. Now, let's get down to the application. Are you following? See, it's not hard for us to know what God wants us to do. Our difficulty comes in the following. Are we being obedient to follow? Are we trusting and obeying? Do you find in your life rest because you're in God's will? Or do you find yourself in unrest, discomfort, disquieted because you're never quite sure, you're never quite certain, you've gone your own way and you don't know if it's God or not? Understand, God wants you to know His will. He makes it plain. Now let's follow. We're going to pray. We'll stand to our feet. The Lord speaks, you need to come. Certainly you can use the altars. You can pray at your seat. The Lord speaks, you need to come. Obey the Lord and come. Dear Heavenly Father, please help during the time of invitation. Pray that You'd help Your people to be obedient. Lord, if there's someone again here today that isn't saved, help them to come. Just step out. We'd love to show them from Your Word how they can know for sure. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. The Lord speaks. As the piano begins to play, you need to come. Obey the Lord and come. What?